We just thank you for this time together, and we just ask that your Holy Spirit would be the teacher, that we would be filled with your Spirit, and just guide what Rick is saying. And we just thank you that you didn't leave us as orphans, that you did leave your Spirit with us to teach us. And so we just invite your Spirit to come and be our teacher tonight. In Jesus' name, amen.
Okay, so we're talking about Jesus, the filler of our needs. Okay. We're talking about soulish needs, love, identity, acceptance, worth, intimacy, security, purpose, and need to be needed, forgiveness. So that's all in this place in Jesus. Okay. And that's what we want to do, is attach ourselves into Jesus. And so how we attach ourselves into Jesus, who is our hope, when he's the source. In fact, I should ask y'all, there's a test. Next week, we'll do it again. But so whenever you think source, you think hope. Whatever your source is of whatever, that's your hope. How you plug into hope is with faith. An electrical outlet is your hope. An extension cord to plug into the outlet is your faith. So our faith is the extension cord of heaven into our hope of who Jesus Christ. Faith is assurance of things hoped for. We focused here on faith being a noun. It's not an action thing. But these are the actions of how we attach our hearts there practically. One is trust. Two is believe. Trust means to attach our heart to. So we're attaching our heart to Jesus. And you trust when you don't have a word. And how you trust, you focus on the nature and character of God, who he is. I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. He's faithful. He's love. He's good. And then you got believe, which means to make firm. You believe when you have a word or a promise. God says something to you. You make it firm. Okay, so that's how we attach in. So to meet a needs, I'm in need of love. So I'm sensing the need of love manifesting in my life. So what I want to do is attach my heart into Jesus, and I'll do it one of two ways. Like trust. And one of the things that I'll do a lot is I really focus on the loving kindnesses of God, you know? And so I'll start to really quote and meditate on passages of scripture and the realities of God's loving kindness or God's love. Or I'm praying, I say, Lord, I need to know your love. And all of a sudden he says to me, Rick, I love you. I mean, and I've had that happen where he just speaks that to me. I love you. So what I'll do is I'll make firm that word. Okay, Lord, I receive that word. And that attaches my heart here. Now, what we want to do tonight is, having attached our hearts into Jesus, the fullness of Jesus will be released back into our lives in three different ways. And we want to look at how those ways will come, that fullness will be manifested into our lives. So the first one is, go with me to Matthew chapter 4, verse 1. What we're after is the fullness of Jesus to be released into every area of our lives, of these nine different areas that where because of sin and death in the world can cause our souls to leak, the fullness of Jesus. And so what we're going to talk about is how this gets released back into our lives. So anyway, it's so 4:1. You got it.
And Jesus was led by the Holy Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. Then Jesus was led by the Holy Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. After he had gone without food for 40 days and 40 nights, he became hungry. And the tempter came. Okay.
So Satan's tempting him. He's hungry. Fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he becomes hungry. That's about as big an overstatement I have ever heard. I miss breakfast and I'm hungry. So my conviction is that when it says he's hungry, what's he talking about here is that literally the full needs are getting manifest. Physical needs, And physical needs, when physical needs get exposed, the real us starts coming out. And notice, you're going to see what's next gets tempted in relationship to this stuff. So read the next verse there.
And the tempter came and said to him, if you are the Son of God, command that these stones become bread.
Okay, if. What does if put in your mind?
Doubt.
Doubt. Okay, so Satan's trying to get him to doubt. Doubt what? What does it say there? If you are the what?
Son of God.
Okay, which of these needs does, if you are the Son of God?
Identity.
Now, watch this. Go back to 3:17, John, and read that.
And behold, a voice from heaven said, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased and delighted.
So God speaks over Jesus, this is my beloved Son. Now, here's an important thing to catch. You know, the Word of God tells us that every word of the Lord is tested. So God speaks over Jesus, this is my beloved Son. So Satan goes, oh, okay, let's see if you are. And so what's really important to catch up here, where you're skipping back down to verse 3, if you are the Son of God, if you are the Son of God, mm-hmm. He's trying to cause the doubt. Now, how is he trying to get Jesus to verify that he's the Son of God? Yeah, perform it, right? Yeah, if you are, prove it. If you are, prove it. You know, if you're a good, you know, picking on John because he's got the mic. If you're a good Christian, fill in the gaps. You know, put this performance on you. You know, if you're a good son, fill in the gaps. And that's what Satan's trying to do with Jesus. If you are. Now, I want to say this to you. Turn these stones to bread. And I want to say this. Y'all, when we start trying to perform, to verify and establish any of these needs, you're dead, because you can never turn enough stones to bread. I mean, like worth. I bet you Q, working at Volvo, there's periods that where y'all lay off people. And I bet you anything, I don't know if Q's had an opportunity to watch this, but good old boys, this worked there for a long time. I take care of my family. I work hard, take care of my family. All of a sudden, they get laid off. So they don't know what the question is, whether they're going to come back or not. And so I guarantee you this, a lot of times this gets, well, if you are a good husband, you'd be taking care of your family. So all of a sudden, guess what? He's not able to take care of his family. I had a guy down at Big Stone who was a good man, taking care of his family, worked in the mines, you know, the coal mines, and just really tried to do what was right. Well, a rock fell out of the ceiling of the mine, hit him in the back, and disabled him. Just enough where he couldn't work. I mean, he couldn't work in the mines. So all of a sudden now, he can't work. So guess what Satan does? Attacks him in this area. Depression hit him, yeah. The thing is, am I doing work out of my heart, faith? This is who I am. But what happens at some point in time, every one of us at some point in time go into this wilderness, and what's the basis for us doing that work? Or even, because like you said, sometime you can't work enough to feel worth it. Yeah. So, yeah, I mean, you're right, but that's still not your worth.
I was only thinking because I know some friends and they're going through a divorce now. And one of the reasons was because, like, I mean, one big issue in the marriage was that the wife felt that the husband couldn't provide or wasn't working. So it just makes me think a little bit. And so it's back to that situation.
Now, here's where I'll say this. Those kind of situations is the need there to me is not here. It would be here or here. The man's forgot who he is. Like, for example, an identity of the Son of God, a son. The most ultimate son is who?
Jesus.
What did Jesus do for the other children, for us children? He died. He gave himself up for him. That's the characteristic of a son, is the son lives to help fulfill the needs of the others. So this guy is not what?
He's laying his life down to.
He's not walking as the other thing is, I bet you anything, this need a purpose. You know, it says where there is no vision, people what?
Perish.
Well, perish, but literally means cast off restraint. Mm. So that you don't see them, they're just hopeless in their just whatever mentality. And so this guy catches vision that is purpose. You purpose as a to express the nature of Jesus in this age. You know, I mean, that's who you are to work. I mean, that's who you are. That's part of your purpose. You know, I would say this guy, he got attacked in another area. And I would say this one most likely, because I would say he had a strong orphan mentality. My conviction is, y'all, you find somebody that's hurting in some way, shape, or form, one of these needs are manifesting. If Deanne doesn't drink water, what's going to happen to your body? How do you know that you need water? You're thirsty. What does that mean?
I'm dry.
Okay. Those are some characteristics of thirst. You have a need of sleep. What's the characteristic of that?
Yeah.
You know, you get tired. Yeah, can't keep your eyes open. There's symptoms for physical needs. You're hungry. Stomach starts to growl. You know, whatever can be other things. Those are physical symptoms that tell you of physical needs. Here's the really crazy thing is, there are symptoms in Scripture about all these nine needs. So it's really important to me as a minister of the gospel that when I sit down with somebody, like the guy that you're talking about, I'm going, okay, what's happening here? I know something's happening right here. Why did King Saul want to kill David? Why was he disobedient to the Lord?
Clearly some needs are manifesting.
Okay, which one? Go to 1 Samuel 15. Watch this. When Samuel went to anoint Saul as king, where was Saul at? He was hiding in the luggage. Why? Look at this in verse 17 of 1 Samuel 15. Saul gives in to the people's demands and gets scared. And notice how Samuel rebukes him.
Samuel said, "Is it not true, though you were little in your own eyes, you were made the head of the tribes of Israel, and the Lord anointed you king over Israel?"
He's what? He's wrestling with identity. You remember when all of a sudden, right after David killed Goliath, you know, David kills his 10,000, Saul kills the thousands. What is happening? He's getting tempted right here. Need of identity is causing him to act and be disobedient to the Lord. Look at Numbers chapter 13, 32 and 33.
So they gave out to the sons of Israel a bad report of the land which they had spied out, saying, "The land through which we have gone in spying it out is a land that devours its inhabitants, and all the people whom we saw in it are men of great size."
Okay, get this now. What? Watch this. They gave out a bad report. Why? Okay, read 33Q.
"There also we saw the Nephilim, the sons of Anak are part of the Nephilim, and we became like grasshoppers in our own sight, and so we were in their sight."
They're here. You got a grasshopper, what I call grasshopper syndrome. They're seeing the giants, and they're going, they don't know who they are. Need of identity is manifesting. And also, with the people, go to chapter 14, verse 2 and 3.
"All the sons of Israel grumbled against Moses and Aaron, and the whole congregation said to them, 'Would that we had died in the land of Egypt, or that we had died in this wilderness. Why is the Lord bringing us into this land to fall by the sword? Our wives and our little ones become plunder. Would it not be better for us to return to Egypt?'"
So guess what? "Would that we had died in the land of Egypt." What of these do you think's manifesting in their life?
I guess they have a need for security.
That's exactly right. Security. They don't know who God's with them. And look on the flip side. Look at Joshua and Caleb 6-9.
"Joshua, the son of Nun, and Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, of those who spied out the land tore their clothes. And they spoke to all the congregation of the sons of Israel, saying, the land which we passed through to spy out is an exceedingly good land. If the Lord is pleased with us, then he will bring us into this land and give it to us, a land flowing that which flows with milk and honey.
Okay, so notice if the Lord is pleased with us, then he'll bring us into this land and give it to us. And notice verse 9.
Only do not rebel against the Lord, and do not fear the people of the land, for they will be our prey. Their protection has been removed from them, and the Lord is with us. Do not fear them.
Notice what he said. Be honest with me. My conviction is they're showing that in this place right now, they are full in relationship to this and this. And I'll show you the identity part, but the security is the Lord's with us. Their protection has been removed from them. So they know their Lord, the God, is with them. And who's with him? God's with him. For us, who can be against us? Really, the Lord showed me identity involves two things. First is there's identity in Christ Jesus. You know, any man that's in Christ, he's a new creation. My God shall supply all my needs according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus. Our identity in Christ Jesus. But the interesting thing God has been showing me, there's another facet to identity. The identity of the one who is in us. Greater is he that is, what, in us than he that is in the world. So when we catch revelation of the identity of the one is in us, dude. And so that's what Joshua and Caleb, even though God's not, quote, in them, they caught a revelation who God was, and they're going, their protection's removed. They're ours. John chapter 11. Why did the Pharisees kill Jesus? Well, you remember a while ago, I was talking to you, Satan's goal is to cause doubt and then cause us to try to turn stones to bread. Here's my conviction. Well, I think the word of God is pretty clear here. Why the Pharisees wanted to kill Jesus. All right, Q, read 47 and 48.
Therefore, the chief priests and the Pharisees convened a council and were saying, what are we doing? For this man is performing many signs.
Get that. What are we doing? You know, and I watch this in churches when all of a sudden, or pastors meetings, and you get there and you got pastors and they're all together. And there's one over there. Oh, man, how many people are in his church? Oh, they're over here, man, I only got 14. He's got 5,000. Oh, wow. Oh, he's a big dog. Because guess what? All of a sudden, what are we doing? They're seeing Jesus here. And they're seeing himself here. And that's what it says. Look at verse 48.
If we let him go on like this, all men will believe in him. And the Romans will come and take away both our place and our nation.
Yeah, they're afraid. It's this one. Security. What are we doing? If you'd have been there in a fly on the wall and you heard the Pharisees saying that, and I go, wait a minute, Pharisees, what are you talking about? You know, don't you know that Jesus is? Don't you know, accept Jesus and find out who you are. You know, find out what he says about you. You know, I'm exaggerating here and kind of running my mouth. But I'll be honest with you, I've done this too many times with people in their lives, is that God will, you know, tell them, you know, find a hole in their life and find out where they're leaking and go, okay, God, let's fill that area. Okay, let's go back here. Okay, so we've attached our heart to the Lord through faith and hope. Now, this fullness is going to come back into our hearts so that you'll know how it's coming. Matthew 4. And he answered him and said, it is written, man shall not live on bread alone, but every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Now, this passage of scripture is a quote from Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 3. And God speaks it to Moses, and he says that you would know and understand that man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. So what God is revealing there is that to live physically, you have to have, quote, bread's a type for nourishment, for physical food. But what he's also revealing in this, that you and I are created in a way that we live and exist off of words. And one of the ways that Jesus will fulfill your needs is the Word of God. Why is Facebook so powerful? It's a counterfeit of this. People will feel good about themselves if they make a quote and they got 1,500 likes. If they make a quote, put it on and nobody says anything, or they get a few dislikes, I guarantee you this, they'll feel depressed. One of the reasons why social media is so strong in our society today is because of this principle right here. And Satan knows it. Man does not live on bread alone, but every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Okay, well, I'll give him the counterfeit. I'll give him the word of people. And so if they get the word of people, guess what? This will not have an effect in their lives. They won't go here. Let me give you an example of this on the flip side, and then give you an example on the other side. Go to John chapter 12, verse 42 and 43.
Nevertheless, many, even of the rulers, believed in him, but because of the Pharisees, they were not confessing him, for fear that they would be put out of the synagogue, for they loved the approval of men rather than the approval of God.
That word for approval literally means glory, thoughts and opinions and recognition. So what they're afraid of being put out of the synagogue. Why? Where's this fear coming from? Well, they love the glory of men more than the glory of God. Instead of feeding on this, they're feeding on the glory of man. Now, since we're here, let's already do this. Watch this. How you attach your heart to the need filler is with faith. By either trusting or believing. Okay? So it's faith. By either trusting or believing. The word of God is what will sustain your soul. What happens if you do not entertain this? You start to entertain that. So after we teach tonight, Deanne goes, "Man, Rick, great word." Okay, that's cool. But what if I teach to hear that? What's going to happen to me?
Yeah, if you don't hear it, then you'll start, feeling lack in one of these particular
areas. There you go. Yeah. You start to hunger. That's exactly right, Q. One of these areas. Really, most likely, that would be either worth or acceptance. I know some ministers that won't let anybody else go to the hospital and visit the sick because they feel like somebody would be taking their place and they wouldn't be any point of acceptance.
If that person steps in front of what God is doing, would the need for like the purpose being there too, like their purpose will change from them, like from God doing it? And I don't know.
Yeah, you're on something. So what's happening to this person here? Instead of attaching their heart on Jesus, they start trying to attach their heart here.
Their purpose would switch compared to them teaching the word, which was the purpose of delivering the truth. And then they switch to, like, say, for instance, Deanne said to good word, Rick. And then you would try to like perform out of that.
There you go. To
get that.
I turn stones to bread, is what you're telling?
Yeah, but their purpose will no longer be the purpose of God. Their purpose would be the purpose, like to accept that word from person.
That's good. That's good. Yeah. Look at this, John 5:44. This person here is in need. They need to attach their heart to Jesus. What's happened to them? Why are they in need? Why are they in need? What? They're not being able to attach here. I drew this. They're attaching here. Watch what happens. Look at that. Read the 5:44.
How can you believe in me when you seek and receive glory and approval from one another, and yet you do not seek the glory and approval which comes from the one and only God?
So all of a sudden, this person, instead of receiving the word of God and what God says, they're stuck on receiving the glory of people. So guess what? They're going to be in there. How can you believe? Somehow they're going to get hungry right here.
When your profession or the work that you do, it revolves around, like, say, you know, social media, where you are in relationship with people, but you're also geared towards making a post that would impact or things like that. And the idea of it is to build your social media to basically coach, like what I'm into. And what is there a place that you just need to be able to, I don't know, be in the word of God that much more so that you don't lose the focus of like what you're doing, but then not getting distracted by how many people viewed this or how many people that, you know, that type of thing. Like your purpose is to be able to make impact to other people, but to remain in the word of God so that when maybe you don't get what you were looking for or something like that, I don't know, you don't begin to lose your identity in that or your worth, that type of thing.
Okay. First off, me saying what I said about Facebook or anything, it's not saying that Facebook is in and of itself is evil. What I do with Facebook is, if I use Facebook to discover who I am, I'm doing this. But if I use Facebook, if I use telephone to communicate and talk to Don, phone's not bad, but if I use the phone to feed off of Don's words, then it's all of this is the heart. And it's all about why I'm doing something. Preaching's not a bad thing, but if I do it to get, like you were talking about, if I do it to get accepted, how do you know if your heart is attached here? Go with me to John chapter 6, verse 63. One of the ways that when we attach our hearts here, what gets released back into our lives is the fullness of God to be released back into our lives through the word of God. But what does John 6:63 say?
It is the spirit who gives life. The flesh conveys no benefit. The words I have spoken to you are spirit and life.
So the words that I speak are spirit and life. How do you know your heart is attached here and this is filling your soul?
By believing.
How do you know if you're believing? I mean, it's a great statement, John, but how do you know you're believing? How do I know if I'm in faith? What does it say? The words that I have spoken to you are what?
Spirit.
So how do I know I'm feeding on the word of God in the spirit? Key word is spirit. How do you know you ever connect anything in relationship to the Holy Spirit? How do you know you're walking in the spirit? How do I know I'm here? I got love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faith, self-control. Now, one step further. How do I know my heart is really attached here? The fruit of the Spirit's manifesting in my life, but how do I know that it's really deep in me? God the Father spoke over Jesus, "This is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased." How do we know that Jesus, when he goes, man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. How do we know that's real in Jesus's life? Okay. Notice this. Okay. God speaks this over him and Jesus declares it. How do I know? We know that it's real for Jesus. Remember in Matthew chapter 4, verse 1, it says this. This is my beloved son, and I'm well pleased. The very next phrase says, the Spirit led Jesus into the wilderness, a place of no props. Just highlighting you, Deanne. One of the things that's blessed me in watching you and try to start your business is that in certain ways, you've been in a wilderness and starting this business. One day I asked you, how many customers you have? And you said, well, I had one sale. But I saw in you a desire of this thing that really communicated to me that Deanne's in, she's in faith and relationship to this. Because she's in a wilderness in relationship to the number of customers. And it's not deterring you. You following me? That's a really good thing. Right? You stay with your heart just where it was when you had zero sales. So that when you get a million sales, same DN that was there when zero sales is the same DN when a million sales. Turning stones to bread don't validate who you are.
One of the ways I know if I'm walking with God or not is to monitor my brain. Whatever I'm thinking about, if I'm walking with God, it will reflect, you know, something about God, some truth about God. If I'm taken anything and moved it into idolatry, then my energy, you know, is going over and over.
That's great, Burl. So you used a key word, idolatry. That's really big.
On the same scenario, I tell people, you monitor your brain, you can find out who your God is.
Can you say that again, Burl?
If you monitor your brain, you'll find out who your God is.
That's good. Burl, you used idolatry, and you know what idolatry in the New Testament is? It's called covetousness, and it literally means to hold more. So whatever you seek to hold, so what Burl's talking about, if you monitor your brain, so whatever thoughts you've got is, I've got to have this, I've got to have that, you've deemed as your source, you've set up as an idol. Is that what you're trying to say, Burl? Is that sort of a variation of it?
That's good enough.
Thank you, Burl. Thank you for saying that. That was good. Monitor your thoughts. That's sort of what we were talking about earlier, thoughts.
Upon the thoughts thing, but also the idolatry of things. You know, as I'm getting in the coaching thing, obviously I'm provided with the material and I'm watching videos and stuff. And I'm on the module about money. And I had a moment and I let my husband know, there's a moment in the training where she's like, I want you to write a letter to money. And I was just like, no, I'm not doing that. Like, I'm not going to write a letter to money, because then you're placing money as your God. Like, why are you going to write a letter to money? And then, so that happened this week, but then even crazier today, yesterday I made a deposit in the bank and it was a different lady there than normal. And today I woke up and I had paid the rent yesterday. Today I woke up and the rent had came out, but the amount in the bank account was still double. And I was like, so I go down and I look, I tell you what, there were so many debates in my mind about, do I tell the bank that we have this much extra? Do I just let it be? Do I let them figure it out? And when I went to deposit today, I told them. And the crazy thing was, is the lady says, well, the lady's drawer never came up short or anything. So we don't even know how that got missed. But just the challenge. And so when I text my husband, I said, I could have made the choice to just let it be. And we could have had that money. But then I could have missed out on an opportunity that the Lord has in the future. And those doors could have been shut just because we wanted to keep that money.
That's a good point.
You know, so
that's good.
That's been two cases this week with that type of thing, that just the Lord showing different things.
That's good. You know, sort of like the phrase, what's your pet price of compromise? And what you're saying there is, hey, it's not worth it. You know, you want to honor the Lord in with money. That's good. That's good. You will be surprised how powerful this is to release the fullness of God back into your life in these things. Q and Dorcas just got married. I guarantee you this. There came a point in time that use of the L word was big to Dorcas. But I could think back, you know, when Paul and I, the L word, I love you. You know, trying to feed off of words, but only not the word of God. I mean, it's cool to hear Paula say, I love you. But like the word, one of the most traumatic times Paula will say that she's faced in our relationship is when she realized that I am not the fulfiller of her needs, that Jesus is. She's learned down through these 40, almost 45 years of allowing Jesus to be the filler of her needs. And I'm just a conduit, hopefully, of that fullness, of this fullness being released back into her life.
When you're dating, There's nothing like, you know, set in stone yet, you know. But when you're married, it's like security is more secure.
So, that can be. There is something else though there. And it's this. I'm gonna write this in an extreme religious way, okay? And then I'll do it another way. This word, the word I love you, becomes unholy. Now, what is that? What do I mean when I say that? I'm taking extreme place. One of the characteristics you take holy literally means set apart. It means uncommon and clean. That, take that word uncommon. One of the tough things is about words, especially like I love you or whatever, is that word becomes common. Familiar. Is it familiar or common? And so one of the key ways that those words become real is that you always try to give some type of expression of and a valuing of that impression. It's just focus on the phrase, I love you. Statement is, why is it when you're dating, it seems to be more powerful than when all of a sudden you get married? And my statement is to you, it becomes common. And the goal is in marriage, is that a marriage relationship never becomes common. That the same freshness that you have in the beginning, you have later on. And I'm not saying that I've got this all down pat. So I'm in this same journey. You ever heard the song No Longer Slaves? When it first came out, hot. You ever noticed that once you listen to it for the thousandth time? Oh, then it's a song you praise it. No longer does it cause your heart to do the same thing it did back here. Because what will have the danger is that you hear it and you just go, you don't value it. It becomes common to you. Mark chapter 4, I think it is, 23 through 25.
If anyone has ears to hear, let him hear and heed my words. Then he said to them, pay attention to what you hear. By your own standard of measurement, it will be measured to you, and you will be given even greater ability to respond, and more will be given to you besides. For whoever has a teachable heart, to him more understanding will be given. And whoever does not have a yearning for truth, even what he has will be taken away from him.
So you got the amplified, so it's obviously adding things. Whoever has, to him shall be given more. Whoever does not have, even what he has shall be taken away from him. What does it mean, taken away from him? Y'all, this is all in the context of the word of God. If you'll notice earlier in the chapter, it's talking about the parable of the seed and the sower. And notice what Jesus says. If anyone has ears to hear, let him hear. Take care what you listen to. Luke uses another phrase that says, take care how you listen. When you hear something, it's very important to always give expression to it. You hear, see, or feel something, and you do not give expression to it of gratitude or appreciation, your heart will become hardened. Hebrews chapter 5, verse 11 says, your hearts become dull of hearing. We're made that way, that what you deem as common, your heart, your subconscious will start to block it out. So I love you. God forbid that we would ever say, I love you out of habit. And God forbid that we would ever hear it as, oh, okay. And so the key would be, John, first off, you know, God, forgive me for my heart becoming hardened to I love yous. I remember one time a friend of mine, he was working in our barn when we lived out in Reiner. And he had a wood shop set up in there, and he would drive every morning to our house. And there were all a lot of pastures that he would pass. And he said, Rick, did you see that big field of flowers out there? And how beautiful they were. And I go, I didn't see it. And then I realized, and the Lord spoke to me, says, you've become dull, the flowers. So what I did was, I repented. I said, Lord, forgive me for allowing the sight of a beautiful flower to be common. So what I did was I repented. I said, Lord, forgive me. And then what I made a conscious choice to do, every time I saw a flower, I would give expression. I would say, you know, Lord, thank you. Oh, that's a beautiful flower. And you know what it started happening in my heart? I would see flowers wherever I went because my heart became sensitive to it. There was a guy I know, awesome man of God. He's having a party at his house. A whole bunch of people there. And this was down in Florida. He's living down in Florida. And he said there were so many people there. He decided to go outside on the back porch and just get a breath of fresh air. He steps out on the back porch and he notices this guy leaning over his flower garden, just like listening. And he goes, what you doing? And the guy goes, did you know that you got 14 species of crickets in your flower garden right here? Peter goes, no, no. Peter goes, I didn't know there were crickets there, you know? And the guy goes, yeah, you got 14 different species of crickets right here. Well, Peter got the guy talking. The guy was a PhD in entomology, a study of insects from the University of Florida. And he specialized in crickets. And he developed that he could identify by sound over 250 different species of crickets. And how he trained his ear to hear crickets, he would ride down the road, back road, real slow, country road, with his window down. And what he would do is he would listen for crickets. Whenever he heard a cricket, he would go and hunt it down. He would listen to it, hear the sound, go find the cricket and identify the species of cricket by the sound. He trained his ear. He sensitized his ear to the sound of cricket. Where Peter kept hearing crickets and he goes, nah, you just want to forget about it. Well, this guy trained his ear to hear. So to say that, train your ear to hear I love yous. Become sensitive. Give expression. Oh, thank you. I received that, you know, whatever, you know. You know, whatever God would give you, spicing it up to be creative in it. But you hear my heart in sharing that? Because notice what it says here in verse 20, 24 and 25. The standard of measure you use is the measure it'll be given you. And notice what it says. Whoever has, to him shall be given. And whoever does not have, what he has shall be taken. What does that mean, shall be taken? It's that when you hear it and you're not careful how you listen, it'll be taken. Picking on cue. You got born again with Jared and all that crew, right? Then at some point in time, you heard about gifts of the Spirit. Do you remember how when you first started hearing about tongues and you go, woo! And if you're not careful, oh, tongues? Oh, and you could go a day or two or three, not even pray in tongues. Because why? It starts to become unholy or common. It just becomes common. what you don't want to make sure. That's something all of a sudden being taken from you. There's times that I've gone a significant period of time without praying in tongues. And I'm going, boy, what have I done? I've allowed something to be taken from me that God has given.
When B says, I love you to A, and it becomes unholy to A because it's common to them, that means that their ears become dull.
So A speaks to B, I love you.
Yes.
Okay, keep going.
B hears it, but it's common. That means that their ear is dull.
Yeah, his ear is dull. Yeah, that's okay. A good way. Because he stopped giving expression to it.
Right. But it can also be a deeper level where he's not walked into the fullness of Jesus because it may have the need of acceptance.
Or love.
Security. Or love, yeah. Or self-acceptance, too. You know, just...
Well, that's, you done uncovered something else. You're thinking right on track. And what you're, just put it this way, what you're saying is really big. Imagine this cup has holes in it. Okay? What happens is when we're in need of love or one of, it's use love here. It's like holes are poked in the side of this cup. And we'll talk about how things, holes get poked in the side of your cup. So all of a sudden, they get, I love you, spoken into them. So I pour water into this cup that has holes on it. What happens to the water? Flows out. So it's not going to be full. So what you're saying is, John, if B has holes in his cup of his heart, and he's, I love you is being said to him, it's doing what? It's just draining out. So the question we got to deal with, we're not going to do it tonight, but how do you patch the holes? What causes the holes? Because the reality is, in Jesus, you got fullness all the time. Question is, why does my cup leak? That's what you're saying, John, was super big. See, I told you had teaching in you. A whole bunch of things can cause it. Well, let's put it this way. Searching for the words of men for fulfill needs creates holes.
Lord, just thinking that we have the opportunity at the end to laugh and be in joy of you, of your word, Lord. Lord, just as thank you for Rick being the vessel of your word tonight. And that the words that was spoken through Rick, that we get to have our hearts to hear that, Lord, and to really receive what has been spoken and tune our hearts to hear clearly what to hear, how to hear you and only you. Thank you for your faithfulness, Lord, and just bless our night and just pray that everyone gets home safely in your name. Amen.
Amen.